Hello, I'm Ed McCrane, Sarasota County's Emergency Management Chief. I'm going to spend some time with you today to talk about hurricane season in the midst of COVID-19 and what you need to do to be prepared this season. First, I'd like to talk about the emergency management team. Now, a lot of people think emergency management is a very large organization, but really there's only six of us on a daily basis. But our job is to coordinate our activities with every other agency in Sarasota County, including you, the public, the business world, private, nonprofit sector, and we all work together to prepare, respond, and recover from any kind of emergencies that could happen. And this time of year, we have to think about hurricanes. We work out of this building. This is the County Emergency Operations Center, located at 6050 Porter Way. This building was erected in 2015. We moved in, and we are 5 miles from the coast, not in a flood zone, self-sufficient building, built to withstand any category of storm. So this is where we operate. Your 911 center operates out of there daily, and we're there so that we can be able to respond during the storm and after the storm to the needs of the community. Hurricane season began on June 1st. It runs through November 30th. Now, we did have a couple storms in May this year, so it's not exactly only between those months. You have to be prepared even beyond November, but primarily this is what we look for. This year, they tell us we're looking at an above average season, but it only takes one storm, so it doesn't matter what the numbers are. We watch every storm that rolls through the Atlantic, Caribbean, and the Gulf of Mexico to be prepared for that, and you need to do the same. You need to make sure you have all the things ready, and we're going to talk about those in this presentation. One of the biggest responsibilities that we have at the county government and city government is to make sure our citizens are out of harm's way when a hurricane is coming. One of the major threats of a hurricane is storm surge. And we, being along the coast, have many areas that are low-lying that could be inundated with that storm surge. Storm surge is particularly bad in the Gulf of Mexico because of the continental shelf. Our water offshore is very shallow, and it can present very high surge action when that storm pushes that water towards the shoreline. Storm surge does a lot of destruction to bridges, barrier islands, and this is why we need to get everybody out of harm's way. So if you live in one of those evacuation levels, like A or B, and you're closer to the water, you can expect to evacuate if we are anticipating any kind of storm surge threat. This photo is from Hurricane Michael. Now, somebody took this photo as the surge was coming in, and we don't recommend that. We recommend that everyone evacuate. Do not stick around. You wait till the last minute, you could find yourself in harm's way. We like to say run from the water and hide from the wind. These pictures are also from Hurricane Michael from the Mexico Beach area after the storm. You can see what the water destruction and wind can do to structures along the coastline. This was a Category 5 hurricane with about 16 feet of storm tide. Hurricanes also bring in a lot of debris. This is from Hurricane Ike in 2008 in the Galveston area. So anything that is closer to the water and it gets destroyed is going to end up where that water finally reaches. And we have contracts in place to make sure we pick this up. And there's a lot of different types of material in these debris fields. So we ask people to stay away from these and be careful. There's hazardous material, flammable material, insecticides, motor oil, and maybe even dead animals and possibly people. So please stay away from these areas after the storm. Now, to know if your business or your home is in one of our evacuation levels, we have a tool at scgov.net that will help you do that. The storm surge map is easy to pick up in one of our evacuation guides, but it doesn't give you enough detail to know exactly where your home is in relation to that. If you go to scgov.net under Know Your Level, at the top bar there, you'll see where it says, I want to. You select I want to, then you go down to Find My Evacuation Level. Once you do that, you're going to get this map. In that upper right corner with the arrows pointing, you want to put in your home address or your business address. When you do, you'll see where you are in reference to those evacuation levels. You may be in A, B, C, D, E, or not in an evacuation level if you're in the white area on the map. This particular residence is in level C. That is actually the Venice Community Center. You can see it's surrounded by low-lying areas around it, and it's on a barrier or a man-made island, the island of Venice. So this way, you know that if we in emergency management call for evacuation of level A and B, that pertains to you if you live in those areas. The other reason we evacuate is for hurricane force winds. Winds in excess of 100 miles an hour, 150 miles an hour do a lot of devastation. They take down trees, power lines, they can destroy homes that are not protected. This is a business in Charlotte County in Punta Gorda after Hurricane Charley. Many thousands of roofs were destroyed by the winds of Hurricane Charley. So you need to make sure your roof is in good repair, that you don't wait till the last minute and let it go on and on. If it needs repair, get it fixed, and always protect your windows and doors. You can use a variety of things to do this. You can purchase impact glass, impact resistant windows, if you can afford that. If not, you can use plywood. You can use different types of shutter material. And I like to practice what I preach there. So there's my home during Hurricane Irma. When Hurricane Irma came, I had to shutter and board up my home, and I have a variety of products that I use. I have some steel shutters. I have some clear shutters on the front of the house to let light in, because it's very important to have some natural light in there so you don't feel like you're locked up in a cave and you can't see out of anywhere. And then you can use a variety of things like hurricane screens to protect your larger windows or sliders, door openings on the patio. And then, of course, you want to have a hurricane-rated garage door to protect that. That's the largest opening to your home. And if that gets breached, you can possibly lose the roof and the windows would blow out as well. Tornadoes are another threat that we encounter during hurricane season. In the storms, in the outer bands, and a hurricane does not have to come straight at us to present those tornadoes. Hurricane Dennis in 2005 was way offshore in the Gulf of Mexico, and it spawned many dozen tornadoes in the Tampa Bay area. So you need to make sure you have a good idea of where in your home is the safest spot to go. We call that the safe area or the safe room. Away from windows and doors, possibly a closet, a bathroom, a small bedroom, and you stay down low until that threat is over. You should get a warning on your cell phone or if you have a weather radio letting you know a tornado warning has been issued. There's many ways to get that warning. Today, many people have smartphones or cell phones that will provide that type of warning I just described. You can also sign up for different types of warnings. We have something here in Sarasota County that's new this year called Alert Sarasota County, and we're going to talk about how you sign up for that. Now, the five-day error cone, or the cone of uncertainty as it's sometimes called, is a tool that we use, and you're probably very familiar with this if you lived in Florida. And this is where you can tell where the storm is now and where they expect it to be within the next 5 days. When we see that Sarasota County is in that five-day cone, we begin our preparations, and you should do the same. And even the cone is not 100% perfect. 24 hours out, that track could also be 100 miles to the left or right of the center. So don't pay attention to the center of the cone. Pay attention to the entire cone. And even areas to the left and right of the cone can get some type of hurricane damage. You're going to know if we are within that threat area as well by getting a hurricane watch or hurricane warning from the National Weather Service. If you hear that Sarasota County is under a hurricane watch, then we have 48 hours before we can anticipate conditions to deteriorate and get those hurricane force conditions or tropical storm force winds. If we're still in that threat 36 hours out, we'll get a hurricane warning. These are all indicators that you need to finalize your plan and make sure that you know where you're going to go. The three things you need to do to be ready is get a kit, make a plan, and stay informed. And we're going to talk about each of those briefly. Many years ago, we had a campaign here in Sarasota County called The First 72 Are On You. But we've learned in recent hurricanes that 72 hours is not enough. You saw how quickly the supplies were depleted from the shelves during COVID-19's threat. Imagine COVID-19 still with us and a hurricane as well. So get your supplies now and have at least 1 week. So that first week is on you. What that means is you need to have those supplies because you won't be able to go to a store. Stores may not be able to open. They may not have power. They may be completely destroyed in your area. And we will be bringing in supplies with the help of the state government and FEMA, but you need to be prepared to take care of you and your family as long as possible until we can get things reestablished. Our hurricane disaster guide or our disaster planning guide will give you 10 steps that you need to prepare. And we'll talk about some of those steps. They may not all apply to you. If you don't have a pet, you don't have to worry about that step. But you may not live in a single family home. You may live in a condominium association or another type of community where you have an association manager. I would get with them and find out what the policies and procedures are for that particular property and how they pertain to you. Should I stay or should I go? That's one of the first decisions that you have to make. And we talked about the evacuation level earlier. That's one factor. If you live in one of the evacuation levels that we're going to call for evacuation due to storm surge, you need to go ahead and evacuate. If you're not sure what your home could handle, you need to study that. You can do a mitigation study. Many roads will flood, so if your plan is to evacuate, you don't want to wait till the last minute to do that. If your home was built after 2002 using the Florida Building Code and you've added shutters, either plywood or commercial shutters, or you have impact windows, you have the hurricane-rated garage door, you're not in an evacuation level, you're pretty safe to stay home. You'll probably be more comfortable at home. Just gather your supplies and invite friends or family over that don't have the luxury that you do and have that home to stay in. Invite them over and bring the supplies and share that comfort and that safety together. During Hurricane Irma, 10 people stayed at my house along with 5 dogs. I was at the Emergency Operations Center, but these were neighbors that did not have hurricane shutters. So prepare your home now. Use that money that you might have used for a vacation or something luxurious to put hurricane shutters, protect your home, protect your windows, get a new roof so that you can stay in your home during hurricane season. We do have evacuation centers, sometimes called shelters, at our schools, but they're not exactly the most comfortable place to be. And you could lose power there as well and be with many hundreds and maybe thousands of people in the same facility. A mitigation inspection of your home can be done very easily. Many building inspectors do this. There's companies that specialize in this. And it's about $150, maybe $200 or less. You hire this person, they come, they do an inspection of your roof, the tie downs, the construction of the walls, the types of windows, and they'll give you basically a scorecard with photos of all of these things. You can share this with your insurance company and get a reduction in your premiums. And you can also figure out what else you need to do to improve that study so that you have better protection of your home by taking the information on that inspection and utilizing it to upgrade your house. Now, if you determine you can't stay, we talked about the evacuation centers. We'll talk about those a little bit more in a second. But you need to make sure that you have a place to go. Talk about it now with friends or family that live in a home that is protected, that do have hurricane shutters. They're not in an evacuation level. Or if your plan is to go to a hotel, research those hotels that are outside of the area that will have the type of protection you need to get out of the storm. If you want to go a long distance, you can leave the area, but you need to think about the traffic. You need to think about other routes to take. And if you must go to an evacuation center, there's some steps you need to take there too. If you're going to leave the area, be prepared for a lot of traffic. Like I said, be prepared to fill up your gas tank when you get to about halfway. Don't wait till it gets down to E and you're struggling to try to find a station. Use the tools that you have on your smartphone to locate gas stations along your route or off of the route and call them up. See if they have fuel. Please don't carry extra cans of gas in the trunk or inside of your vehicle. Very dangerous practice. Just make sure that you top off before you leave and that you stop, like I said, at half a tank and top off that vehicle. If you've evacuated the area, don't come back right away. Check in. You can call 861-5000 in Sarasota County for information. You can check websites. You can check with your association to see if it's safe to come back, if power's been restored, if the roadways are back open. You don't want to get out there and venture out, especially if you're staying in the area. Don't go out immediately after the storm either, because you could probably end up with nails in your tires and have 4 flats on the side of the road. That's not a good situation to be in. For your home, you want to protect it. Even if you evacuate, do everything you can to protect your home. Put away loose items. If you live in an area that may flood, take those important items with you or raise them above the floor level. If you own a business, you should protect your business as well. You should notify your customers what your plans are, when you plan to close, so that they can make those last minute trips to you. You should notify your vendors. and do everything you can to protect that business so you can get back in business after the storm is over. A good practice is for everybody to pack their own emergency kit. We talked about that 1 week worth of supplies, but you also have to have some personal items. And depending on the number of members of your family, everybody should have their own little backpack or suitcase that they can pack in extra clothes, shoes, flashlight, medications, some snacks, things like that. It's very important too, in Florida, many people like to wear sandals or flip-flops all the time or run around barefoot. After a hurricane hits or a tornado, there could be a lot of broken glass and debris, so you make sure, especially for your children, that you have a good pair of shoes and socks for them to wear after the storm during the recovery period. Hurricane evacuation centers, we have 11 that we will open simultaneously. Now, in previous years, during Irma, we would open three or four at a time, and after our action review that we did, we decided it'd be a good idea to open all 11 so you know which ones are going to be open. And if it's not on the list and if it's not being announced in the media, it is not an evacuation center and it won't open. Now, COVID-19 has presented some challenges because of the capacity. The number of people that we can hold in these facilities has been reduced, probably about 50%, because we have to apply social distancing and other procedures to make sure that we keep people as safe as possible. All of our evacuation centers are also pet friendly. We had four or five in the past that were, but again, after Irma, we learned that people will show up at facilities that are not deemed pet friendly or are not equipped to handle the pets, and they're not going to turn people away, so they were let in, and a lot of damage was done to the schools. So working with our partners at the school district, emergency management looked at each campus of those 11 that we use and the two medical shelters that we use, and found areas within the school that we could house pets safely, that had wood, concrete floors or tile and not carpeting, and things like that, like locker rooms and chemistry rooms and such. Evacuation centers should be considered the last resort. They're the lifeboat. The lifeboat that'll get you through the storm. It's a safe building that we've checked out that we know is not going to flood. It's not going to be in the storm surge zone, and it's not going to be destroyed by hurricane force winds. But they are going to have a lot of people. Normally, before COVID came into the picture, you would get 20 square feet of space, and we would allocate that for every individual. And then you would set up your sleeping bag, your cot, your air mattress or whatever, and you'd be right there next to all the other people. Because of COVID-19 and CDC guidelines giving you more space, that whole 6 foot distance that we talk about, we're going to use 40 square feet. So that takes our capacity down 50% in the evacuation centers. And there's still going to be a lot of people there. We're also going to do a few things to protect you and to protect ourselves and our staff. While you're in these evacuation centers, you can expect a screening. That may change depending on what the status of the virus at the time, but you can expect a screening. We'd ask you to please bring that cloth mask that you're using every day. Bring a couple of them. Bring some hand sanitizer. Now, we will have some masks on hand for those that don't have them, couldn't get them, but please bring yours if at all possible. We're going to ask that you wear that inside the center, that you also maintain that social distancing in all areas. The school custodians are going to be there to make sure that areas are sanitized more often than normal, actually, but we need you to do your part as well if you come to one of these centers. And then we may have to change how we do feeding. Instead of everybody lining up and going to the cafeteria together, there may be some food deliveries to certain areas, or you may have to just wait and go in smaller groups. But those instructions will be given to you if you arrive at an evacuation center. But remember, this is the last resort. Don't make this your first choice. Start planning now on another place to go. Stay home if you can, or stay with friends or family. Plan your evacuation route. I can tell you right now, I-75 will be a parking lot. It always is when we have an evacuation, and even during rush hour, especially if there's a small fender bender along the way. Think about other areas. If your plan is to leave and you want to go east or you want to go north, take State Road 72, which goes into Arcadia, and then you can take one of the roads north, 17, 27, or 95 even. Sometimes it's a good plan to go south to the Miami or the Palm Beach area if the storm isn't going to threaten that area. Or State Road 64, State Road 70, those will all go east and take you to those northernbound routes. You don't have to go hundreds of miles away. You can go tens of miles. Remember, run from the water, hide from the wind. That's the key. Hurricane Irma taught us a lot in Sarasota County, and we took advantage of that and did an after-action review, where we came up with 95 enhancements to our plan, things that we could do better, like opening all 11 shelters simultaneously, making them all pet-friendly. There's some other things that we came up with. We actually brought in the recently retired administrator of FEMA, Craig Fugate, who used to be the director of the State of Florida Division of Emergency Management. Him, and along with a state, a county, and a city emergency manager, looked at how we performed during Irma, gave us some suggestions, pointed out what we did well, and gave us some enhancements on how we could do things even more effectively. One of the most important things that we established with the partners from the school district and SCAT, our transportation system, was to develop the transportation dependent plan. Now, this plan is to help people that no longer drive or don't like to drive a long distance. You can get to one of the rally points that will be announced throughout the county, and you'll be taken by bus from there to the evacuation center. You can bring your pet in a crate. You can bring your two bags each and your supplies, and we will make sure you get there safely and return you to the rally point afterwards. If you don't have a car, if you can't get a ride to a rally point, and you need to be picked up from your home, you can do that as well. What you do is you go to our transportation dependent plan on scgov.net by going to I want to register for the transportation to evacuation centers. When you do that, you'll get information on this slide, and that page will direct you to how to sign up by giving us your name, address, phone number, so that we can contact you, make sure that you're established in the system, and then contact you before the storm to make sure you still need a ride. You'll get a confirmation back once you've done that, and again, you'll get a phone call from the staff at some point in the near future. The rally points will be established. They'll be clearly marked. They'll be expressed in the media and through our communications team on our Facebook and our other social media pages. And they also will have a flying flag that says rally point at those locations. They're typically going to be county or city or school board type buildings that have large parking lots. If you or your friend have medical needs, we used to refer this as the People with Special Needs program. But the medically dependent program is established for those that usually do fine on their own with home health care. They have an agency that comes in and takes care of them, helps them with certain issues, provides oxygen, or they're power dependent. If you fit those categories and you're going to need assistance and you can't stay home alone during the storm or even with your caregiver, register for the medical needs program. Again, go to scgov.net. I want to register for the medical needs program. When you do that, you will be given the option to either print out the medical needs form and take your time filling it out with your doctor, your caregiver, then send it to us at the address provided on the form. You can also do it right there on the computer by clicking that link and uploading your information onto the form, and you can come back and update it later. This will go right into our system. Once you are registered in the medical needs program, you will get a call from my staff, and they will ask you to confirm all the information and give you some instructions on what happens. Many people can still drive themselves to the evacuation center. They'll be given instructions to do that for the medical dependent program. Or if you can't drive or don't drive, we will pick you up. We'll also bring the right transportation. If you are wheelchair bound or you need additional assistance, a different type of vehicle, and some of you might even end up having to go to one of our hospitals based on your doctor's orders. We will assist with that as well. But you need to be registered. And we ask you to register now if you fit this category. Please don't wait till the last minute. During Hurricane Irma, we had 2,000 people that we were working with in this program, and over 800 people decided they needed to be part of the program in the last 3 days leading up to the storm. The staff did everything we could to get as many of those people into the system and to the evacuation centers, but you can't put us under that kind of pressure or yourself under that kind of pressure at the last minute. So please don't wait till the last minute. If you think, you even think you're going to need to be in this program, please take the time to register. If you don't have a computer or you don't feel comfortable navigating through these web pages, call 861-5000 and ask for assistance. They can even send you the form in the mail that you can fill out and mail back to us. The Medical Needs Center normally has 60 square feet per caregiver and individual. We're going to keep it that way because that's enough space, and we're just not going to put as many medical needs patients in the same room as we have in the past. For instance, if we could have put 8, we may just put 6 or 4, depending on the amount of people that are there. So keep that in mind. There are medical staff there from the health department and county and school board staff that will assist you. But we ask every medical needs person that if you have a caregiver, spouse, friend, family member that can come with you to assist you in your needs, that would help us and help you as well. Remember, the first week is on you. Don't wait till the last minute. Get prepared today. So something else that came out of the Hurricane Irma after action review was the question of, is it all clear? A lot of people were asking us, is it all clear? Well, what does that mean? The storm is gone, yes. You don't have to worry about the threat of the storm, but the debris and damage it left behind creates some dangers. So we came up with this three-color system. If things are red, that's usually during the storm, immediately after the storm, then we don't want you going anywhere. We'd like you to stay in place. The only people that are going to be allowed to move around are first responders and infrastructure and utility crews. And they're going to be clearing the roads. They're going to be fixing everything that's broken, getting those nails out of the road that would affect you and us as well. Then if things get a little better, we're going to have condition yellow. You can move around during that time, but the term we used in COVID was essential, right? So only essential functions, essential duties, going to the store, going to the hospital, and you need to use caution. There will be trees. They may be pushed to the side of the road. There will be power lines down. Intersections, four-way intersections will be, traffic signals may not be operating. So treat those as a four-way stop. Don't blow through them because you don't see a red light, because the other person coming in the other direction may do the same. So stop, look, and then go. If it's green, we're pretty much back to normal. There's no limiting factors, and we hope that we can do that quickly. But please look out for these different codes. It may be that we show what areas of the county are in different colors at a given time. Reentry. This is really of interest to those that live on barrier islands, but it could be anywhere, really. If we have an area that's totally devastated, or we need to make sure that the bridges are safe and they're all intact and they're safe to travel on, that the water and infrastructure is safe, then we're going to close off these areas with law enforcement. And only those first responders that are working in that area will be allowed to enter. Once we deem it safe, then business owners and residents that have proof that they have a reason to be on there will be allowed on. So you need to have your driver's license, photo ID with that address, or if you're from out of town, you need to have a photo ID and some type of proof that you either work at that business or you live at that home, a utility bill, something with the address, property taxes, something that you can show that you have a reason to be there. And if you have a vendor, if you're a business and you provide service to people on those islands, you need to have them provide you a letter, and that and your proof of ID, your photo ID will help you get over that checkpoint onto the island. You'll be given a wristband by law enforcement to get onto the island. In that way, if you're out of your vehicle walking around, law enforcement will see the wristband and you will not be challenged and asked for ID again. This way we can stop and hopefully prevent looting and other things that are unnecessary that happen after these situations. We've also enhanced our hurricane information process. We're doing things like this video. We have our social media sites. Our communications team does a great job getting the word out with our local media and putting information out on a regular basis. We'll be giving you updates. We'll be doing 2 press conferences a day, and we'll come in, interrupt if something important is happening. We'll be able to do a quick Facebook Live or give the media an opportunity to take our feed and get information out to you. Things like the shelters are now opening, or evacuation centers are now opening. The winds are reaching 45 miles per hour, and 911 calls will not send out emergency vehicles. And how many of you knew that? If the winds get to 45, 50 miles an hour, we don't send out ambulances and fire trucks and police cars anymore. We have to handle things over the phone and give you as much guidance as we can to stop the bleeding or do CPR, but we can't send a vehicle out. So please make sure before those winds get to 45 sustained, you are in a safe location. Again, social media is a tool. Not everybody uses it, but many of you do. So follow Sarasota County Emergency Services Facebook page. The latest, most important information will be posted there. And also at scgov.net. The team here does a great thing and they flip the website onto the storm or that emergency situation's name, and all the information you can find is right there, easy to find. Don't forget 861-5000 too. That becomes the county contact center. Our Twitter page, Sarasota County Emergency Services, we utilize this as well. The media can pick up these short messages with links and maps and photos and share them with you, their listening and watching audience. We have these preparedness fact sheets available at scgov.net under our Hurricane Preparedness link. You go there, you can click these. They're a double-sided color document that basically break down each of the steps you need to have to prepare for hurricane season into individual topics. If we do expos or live seminars, we will have these available on hand at those sites as well. You can invite us to do presentations for you whenever necessary. For now, we can't do in public presentations that often, but we have been utilizing tools like Zoom or Microsoft Teams or GoToWebinar. And if you want to do that, you can call 865-15000 and set it up. But hopefully this video will be something that you can share as well with all of your residents and get the information to many more people that normally couldn't be there in person. We do have the 2020 Disaster Planning Guide available at all of the libraries and at the county buildings. The 2019 is just as good. If you still have that, the only change really is this little game that's in there that walks you through, should I stay or should I go, should I evacuate process. But those are available. If you need several hundred copies, you need to call 861-5000 with the name of your organization and how many you need. We also have them in English and in Spanish. And we can provide those for you and give you an option to come pick them up at the Emergency Operations Center lobby. Alert Sarasota County, I mentioned earlier, is a telephone notification system that we use to, and we replaced something called Code Red that we recently were using for many years. Code Red was very effective, but Alert Sarasota County comes from a system that the state of Florida, Alert Florida, has allowed us to be part of. And we work with our city partners, and we were able to get established on this. You can go to alertsarasotacounty.com and sign up for this. And what happens is you can select what notifications you want. You can get the tornado warning, the boil water notices, and it's based on a geographic tool. So you need to put in a Sarasota County address, either for that home or that business. So if something happens in the vicinity of that area, we can notify you by basically drawing a circle around that area on the map, and everybody who has registered in this system will get notified. Something else that we're doing right now during COVID-19, and we will continue to use this, is in Manatee County, they're using something called you can text Manatee Ready to 888-777, and they will give you an update. And for Sarasota County, it's 888-777. You type in SRQ COVID-19, just like you see on the screen. And the reason I give you both is I monitor both of them as well, because we're right on the county line. We coordinate a lot with Manatee County. Right there along the University Parkway corridor. So I recommend you sign up by doing this. You'll get alerts every time there's a new update. We utilize this tool to get that information to you. Remember, the first week is on you. If you have questions about this presentation, please call 861-5000 or email us at emcrane@scgov.net. We'll be glad to respond to your questions. And we hope that this video was useful to you. We hope that you share it broadly and widely to all of your community so that everybody can get prepared and be safe this hurricane season. Thank you.